8 miles below Durant and 27 miles from the end of our run at Canton. We had been running at very high speed. Weather and visibility were fairly good, and Casey Jones hoped to bring us in on time at 4:05 a.m. Our engine was one specially built for these trains by the Rogers Locomotive Works and had drivers 6 feet tall. On today's fine roadbeds, it would have traveled 100 miles an hour, possibly more. We may easily have reached that speed, and we certainly reach 90 often. The section of the line from Memphis to Grenada had recently been purchased from another railroad, and the track had pretty light rail. This fact, rather than the fast schedule, I think, caused some of the engineers to pass up the job on that fast train. From Grenada to Canton, however, the rails were standard weight. Anyway, the time was made up, put Casey in a good humor, and he talked and joked with me all along. "Sim," he said, "if you keep the old girl hot, we'll go into Canton on time." I said, "Well, I'll keep her hot." And naturally, I did. We took siding at Goodman and were hardly in the clear before number two's headlight showed up from the south. After it passed, we backed out of on the main line and began the last 27 miles of our trip. 15 miles south of Goodman is the little town of Vaughn, approached by an S-curve, which swings first to the right, then back to the left. Naturally, on this type of curve, the engineer and fireman of the steam locomotive cannot see the track ahead at the same time. As we entered the curve, I put in a fire and climbed up and looked out of the cab window on my side, so that when we swung to the left, I could look ahead with a clear view of the siding and station. As we came out of the curve, there right ahead of us were the red rear markers of a train. Showing red meant that it was on the main line. At once I yelled to Casey, "Oh my Lord, here's something on the main line." He jumped to his feet, looked diagonally across the top of the boiler, at the same time setting the air brakes in an emergency stop. He had to reach up to do it, as the valve was located high on these engines. "Jump, Sim, jump," he shouted. I jumped across the deck, grabbed the handrail, slid down as far as I could go, then turned loose. Casey never had a chance. The engineer's seat on one side and the long boiler which divided us, the cab on the other side, made escape practically impossible. Hitting the ground knocked me unconscious. I woke up about 30 minutes later to hear voices say, "Here he is." When I was able to talk, I asked about the engineer, and they told me Casey was killed. We had hit the caboose of the freight train, gone through it, a car of hay, a car of corn, and halfway through a car of lumber, all of them on the main line, the rest of the train on the siding. We had no orders against this train or any other except number two, which we had already passed. Our clearance card gave us rights over everything, and we didn't have to look out for anybody. If a train is blocking the main line, railroad rules require that a flagman must go out 10 telegraph poles distance and place two warning torpedoes two rail links apart, then a stop torpedo. If a train approaches, he must also light a red fusee. This flagman must remain out until called in. Without warning, we plowed into that caboose. The wreck occurred at 3:52 a.m., and as we had only 12 miles to go, with a clear track, we probably would have arrived at Cannon safely on time. If we had been properly warned, Casey Jones might have been alive today.